Hello, welcome to Video Game Animation Study. Today we are concluding a mini-series looking at the five fundamentals of video game animation as proposed by Jonathan Cooper in his book Game Anim, Video Game Animation Explained. Today we're looking at the fundamental of elegance. Jonathan puts it as how much bang you get for your buck. How much can you do with your budget? How much animation can you do with the team and resource you have? How efficient are all the animation systems that are in place, working effortlessly underneath what you can see? Good design involves as little design as possible, so says industrial designer Durrant. And this can be extended to any creative industry.
And remember that we are all animating.
Fumito Ueda has said that Eco adheres to the design by subtraction philosophy. Strip away anything that's not needed, no matter how big or seemingly important. Less is more. Sometimes you have to think smart. Instead of having a whole screen of waving blades of grass, just have them on the horizon, and then have them be represented by patterns as they get closer instead. An animation for turning something can be as simple as this for every object, regardless of size or complexity. Add tiny sparkles to water to completely enrich its appearance without the need for super complex water simulation. It's tempting to go all in and create every animation you'll need, every transition animation, and every combined animation. But as we discussed in previous episodes, there are tricks and shortcuts to enable a more efficient approach in animation construction. Blending different animations over one another saves resource in rigging an entirely separate animation, such as pulling the switch whilst coming to the end of a run. Firstly, it harmed the feel of the gameplay if these animations played separately. The fluidity between these two actions smooths out the motion as a whole. A little head turn looking at the danger adds a tiny bit of charm and life to your character at little expense. This links nicely to procedural animation, where movement is programmed rather than animated by hand, though sometimes it's both. Like we mentioned with Grow Home, movement is dictated by where Bud's feet are and their center of gravity. There's no actual animation which has been programmed. The coding is doing all the work. If you're picking up a lot of objects in your game, then you could perhaps standardize the size and shape of objects so that you can use one animation for all of those objects. Or, heck, remove any need for interaction with objects if it doesn't help or hinder your game at all. If your character automatically climbs or interacts with terrain, then it might be an idea to standardize the height and shape of the terrain. You'll often find that climbable surfaces in Ocarina of Time come in one of two or three heights. Or vaulting over walls and such in Watch Dogs always looks the same because those walls are all made to be the same height. This then strengthens the game design itself, as having these standardized assets makes level design more readable to the player. They'll know where they can climb or vault. This is an elegant system. It saves having too many animations and reinforces the overall design. Obviously, elegance doesn't mean cutting corners. Some games have the budget or resource to polish certain animations if it'll help your game. Firewatch, for example, has unique animations for most objects Henry interacts with. Henry has a rendered body which you occasionally see. You might catch it when opening a safe box, scrambling over terrain or something similar. You don't often see one's legs or body in first-person games. Henry is surprisingly versatile and full of character animations, but this is afforded because he is the only real animated thing in the game. There's some gentle environmental animation, such as birds and swaying trees. There's the occasional piece of event-specific animation. But overall, Henry is where all the resource has gone for the animation team, so they can afford a bit more leeway in producing more glamorous animations. And this is why you don't often see your body in first-person games, because there's many other things to consider elsewhere in the game before luxuries like that. It's not that it's hard, it's just there's other areas to focus on first. Sometimes, though, you can afford the budget and resources for item-specific animations. This is where you have to consider how much bang to get for your buck, figuring out what's important to your game.
I want to know what is worth doing.
If you're a sole developer or small team doing everything, you can still pull off incredible displays of elegance, such as Tom Happ with Axiom Verge, Superhot Team with Superhot, or Team Cherry with Hollow Knight. It's not always about doing things on the cheap. It's doing what feels right for your game. If you want complicated trees of information that form your animation, go for it. If you want to reuse an animation that was for kicking open a door to be kicking an enemy, definitely go for it. If you want all your enemies to have the same animation, go for it. It's all about getting that bang for your buck. What sacrifices should you make? What trade-offs should you allow? Do you render legs or not render legs? Do you make limb-specific damage or have the body react as a whole? Little nugget of information here. I went to a talk with David Doak, who worked on GoldenEye 64, and apparently the team didn't have a game animator. Imagine that. God, I love the Wild West development stories from the 90s. And this is the fundamental of elegance, keeping everything neat and tidy and uncomplicated for what your budget and resource will allow. This concludes the Five Fundamentals series. I hope you've taken away something entertaining and educational from it. Please go and buy the book if you're serious about getting into game animation. This video was sponsored by Skillshare, an online learning community that allows you to learn from industry creative veterans, and it's wicked what you can accomplish. Now that the whole world is on lockdown, now might be a good time to get stuck into a new skill or hobby. It's also cheaper than one-to-one real-world classes, coming in at less than $10 a month when bought annually. I've been using Skillshare more recently, obviously, and have found great lessons to sharpen my skill. This class, Fire and Smoke Simulation by Stephen Pearson, is a cool little one to do, especially as Blender is completely free. So I'd recommend that if you're looking to learn something new and awesome. So the first 500 of my subscribers to click the link in the description will get a 2-month free trial and premium membership so you can explore your creativity. And thanks to my patrons for this one as well. Thanks for sticking with me in this series. I know it's been a bit of a different one, but I thought it'd be a great series for game animators to watch and learn if they're getting into game design, and hopefully interesting enough for casual viewers to learn more about games that they know of. Although recent views show that this hasn't been the most popular of things I've produced, which is a bit of a shame, but hey-ho, that's how it goes sometimes. Hopefully this all drives a bit more traffic to Jonathan's book as well, which is a must-buy if you're getting into game design. Jonathan's been a great help too, helping to shape certain parts of the script and guiding me to examples. Thanks, Jonathan. I'm going to take a bit of a break from video making now. I've been working solidly on videos since Christmas, and frankly, it's a bit exhausting, especially as I've been producing them in the evenings and weekends and days off around my family and job. And obviously, this pesky coronavirus is completely changing the landscape and a lot of things, so priorities are all shifting right now. I'll pick video production up again soon. I'll have a think about how to approach video making going forward, as I don't want to keep repeating the same things about different games. I'll probably come back with a long-form video in the summer, so stick around. Also, I kind of want to work on my own game for a bit, this little space shooter which is all hand-drawn by me. You can play the PC demo right now, the link is in the description. I've done all the art assets, including music and sound effects, and the whole thing works because of my friend Jeremy, who's just a coding wizard. I suggest something, and it's already working by the time I finish my sentence. You can follow our Twitter account, Digitel Games, for updates, and hopefully there'll be more updates now I've got a bit more time to work on it. And you can join our Discord server as well. Okay, I think I may have run on a bit. Stay home, stay safe, wash your hands. Love you, bye.